you all for coming for this personal meeting, and I'm very happy that you all got together. And we had an incredible talk this morning at 10:30, which is very exciting, and maybe perhaps Evyata will tell a little bit about it. But as a host of the Truman Institute, we're very happy to host this meeting. One of our major projects for the past 2 years has been religion and peace, which is actually unlike the, I would say, the usual convention that if we'll separate religion from conflict resolution, everything will work out fine. We think exactly the opposite. We have to integrate religious leaders within conflict resolution, and this is what we are trying to do. And this talk is a part of one component among many in this project.
Okay, so thanks everybody for coming. I'm very happy and honored to introduce to you Kenpo Sodargye Rinpoche, who is the head of the Larungar Five Sciences Buddhist Academy in Larung Valley, in what could be called Kham Tibet or Sichuan, China, depending on the point of view you want to take. And Kenpo gave a very kind of moving talk this morning, and I think maybe I'll repeat the introduction I gave there, because I think it kind of maybe worked to give a sense of. So the way I introduced him, I think the main part was to say that he's the spiritual heir of Jigme Punsok Rinpoche, who founded the Larungar Institute. He's a very, very widely acknowledged and respected teacher he was. He died, you said, 14 years ago, I think, mm-hmm. right? Mm-hmm. Coming from the Nyingmapa tradition of Tibetan Buddhism. And he himself, Jigme Punsok Rinpoche, was a reincarnation, considered to be a reincarnation, of the teacher of the 13th Dalai Lama. Now I lost his name again.
Lerab Limpa.
Yeah. What was it?
Lerab Limpa.
Yeah. Limpa. And then Kenpo, in his talk, actually explained that they trace, I mean, he is known as also one of the students of Padmasambhava, who is the Guru Rinpoche. He's like the founding figure of Tibetan Buddhism in many ways, 8th century. So when Jigme Punsok Rinpoche would go, say, on pilgrimage to some place, this is from his talk. For me, I would say that maybe the top highlight of the talk, right? So he would go to pilgrimage to places where he was with his teacher as a previous incarnation. And then he would discover treasures. If you guys are familiar with the Therma tradition of treasures that Padmasambhava, the great teacher, deposited in different places in Tibet, in the sense of rocks and stones or people's minds. And so he would come to these places and he would remember the verses, he would remember the teachings, and this is what's called, it's a very important textual tradition, revelation, you could say, Tibetan Buddhism. So, I mean, thinking from Tibetan Buddhism, it's coming very, very, very deep spiritual depths, you could say. And so this is the kind of presence that is with us today. And the talk he gave was very much kind of geared to kind of take a different look at life, right, than what I guess we normally take. Or I mean, he's pretty much he framed a lot of what he had to say in the morning in relation to how he would think about things in science, and what's rational and what's not rational, and taking reincarnation as a very kind of maybe simple and serious fact about life, which is something that maybe we're not capable of doing so easily, but so just to say something about a different kind of way of thinking, which may not which could, may not be less reasonable or more reasonable than what we're accustomed to practice around here. But so just to kind of frame what, so the title, the idea of our talk today would be to speak about the relation between scholarship and experience. And this topic was chosen because Buddhism and academic scholarship share very much in common. But then they part in maybe certain places. What I think they share in common would be, first the interest in scholarship and study. Buddhism, sometimes contrary to the way it's normally thought of, is a tradition that's couched in very, very deep scholarly practices. But specifically it's analytic and it's critical. It's very critical of the way of human mind it tends to fantasize and attach very much significance to certain kinds of fantasies. And it's very analytic in the sense that it's always looking, taking things apart and looking at the conditions that cause things to move. So I think in those senses that there's a very kind of a pragmatic orientation, very similar. But then Buddhism, Buddhism is very clear about scholarship being meant to be transformative, to change or to have a positive effect on the way people live in the world, on the way they perceive their reality, on the way they understand themselves or the lack of themselves, maybe. So there's a very different from at least one of the ideals that I think that we're supposed to hold on to here in the university of some kind of detached scholarship, knowledge for the sake of itself. Rather than for any kind of, it's not supposed to, any time we get involved emotionally, then supposedly something's gone wrong. And even though maybe none of us who are like professional academics in this room would necessarily say that that characterizes the kind of scholarship they do or they believe in, nevertheless, I'm not sure we have another ideal. And in the state of things today, in the 21st century with its fast pace, it seems like we may need to kind of begin thinking in those directions or think more in those directions. And so I thought it would be a good opportunity to hear some of Rinpoche's insights on these fields and take it from there.
首先我要表达一下今天我们有这样的一个圆桌的平等的还有一个面对面的有信仰的没有信仰的大家都有这么一个不同的思想和不同的习惯的人坐在一起有一个共同的求知和求真理的这么一个交流平台吧就很感谢这个布鲁门研究系。我今天下午呢可能讲的不多主要是多听一下大家的这种不同的声音但要求让我讲一下刚才相关的几个内容的话首先是我想讲一下那个学术跟那个现在的这种这个体验之间的这种差别就也就是说我的有一些看法包括我去学校去寺院去一些各种不同的人的借助的过程当中在这方面我还是感受比较深现在好像那个学术界跟那个修行体验呢就是好多地方是完全是不同体系的比如说一些宗教徒呢他对学术就并不是很了解甚至很排斥有些就研究人员就是他对这个修行的一些体验甚至呢就是把它当作是一种迷信就是所以好像这个研究跟这个修行就体验呢在不管是东方西方就是在很多范围当中是就完全是这个水火不容的感觉其实我觉得这两者呢就是相辅相成的就不可缺少比如说 我们一个宗教的这个修行人，就是他的这种要体验的话呢，一定要最开始的时候有一种非常严谨的这种学术的这个交流啊，就是包括我们这个藏传佛教当中有很长时间的这种辩论，就是这样的话呢，就是可能牵出了所有的坏意，否则的话呢，一般修行的很多体验都是最后就是从坏意的这种迷雾当中是没办法就是做出来。从学术这个层面讲，应该也需要，就可能是最好是自己有一些修行的这种体验，尤其是他们研究这个宗教，就是宗教领域的很多东西是这个心理的领域。心理的领域呢，就是如果没有去自己去信自，自己去修行的话呢，我看到这个西方有些学者就是一辈子就研究，但是呢，因为他自己的从来没有去实行，从来没有体验，就是最后的话呢，好像是我们从对宗教比较专业的角度来讲呢，就是很多学者他们所研究的这种方法上呢，就是因为他根本没有任何的信仰，没有任何的信仰情况下呢，他去做的有些事情呢，就是可能会不一定能找到就是所需要的，就是真正的这种这个就东西或者是经历。可能这边是本身是有宗教的这种地蕴，就是就几千年的这种，也许可能会哈，我这边的情况不是很清楚。但是西方有些学者呢，他完全是有一种科学的这种领域来观这个我们宗教的这个各种仪式啊，或者说是各种信仰啊，包括心灵的这种状态的话呢，我们就觉得是就可能自己没有就进入的话，好像就是光是依靠文字或者是依靠几本书，也没有老师带着的话呢，就好像他们的这种体验跟那个学术呢，就是完全的是脱节。虽然花了很长时间，但是我感觉上有时候这个效果呢，就是不一定很明显。就是西方有些国家确实这样的这种学者比较多，因此我就感觉，如果一个人他既有学术研究的这种精神，也有一些修行体验的话呢，就是可能最好不过的。即使他没有的话呢，应该是就是有一些涉及到主观意识的这种这个信仰方面的道理，跟客观这个现实生活当中的这些现代的这个知识两个结合起来的话呢，就是可能需要有一种互相了解啊，尊重啊，就是这么一个平台。否则的话，比如说我是一个这个宗教人士，我可能在我的意识当中所得到的这些经济很重要的。我是一个科学家的话，那我从实验室里面就是得到的这种实验的结果很重要的。其实每个人都有他自己的一种这个成就也好，就自己的一种最好的这种体验，但是呢互相的也许是不承认，就是这是我想提到的，就是第一个观点。第二一个呢，就是我们这个宗教对这个和平进程当中的一些可能作用吧。就因为现在这个大多数的这个世间人呢，有些认为是可能宗教就是不但对和平进程没有很大的利益，就是反而可能会导致一些不太好的这种影响，就是也有这种信法。就但我个人的是这个与这个观点是完全相反的。我们这几年也是在有各种宗教的一些，也在泰国，在拉荣，在香港都开了一些各种不同的这个宗教，就是我们把这个话题呢，就是作为有时候是作为各个宗教就是对幸福的这种解读，就有时候是和平的这个解读，有时候是对可持续发展的，就是等等，就是不同的。在这个过程当中呢，其实每个宗教从这个教义的角度来讲呢，就是应该是对人类的和平就是有非常非常大的这个作用。只不过呢，就是这个宗教呢，有时候是可能我们人们就是把它就是拉入这个民族啊，拉入这个政治啊，拉入这个经济啊，就这个时候呢，好像就是这个宗教就利用出来，利用的时候呢，就是它就变成了比较狭隘的这种思想。有时候我看到这个人类的历史呢，应该是比较血腥的，因为从这个自古以来的人类历史一番的时候呢，里面有各种各样的这种冲突啊，各种各样的一些这个矛盾啊，战争啊，就是这样发生。 但有时候认为呢，我们的这个历史呢，应该是带有这个，有些学者认为是人类的历史是一个宗教的历史，就是也有这种说法。那么未来就变成什么样呢？就是大家大多数人来讲是一个未知数。但不管怎么样，就是我认为有信仰的没有信仰的，就是大家都是应该是对这个和平进程，哪怕是一点点的这种作用呢，就是都要去想尽一切办法。因为21世纪呢，就是跟以往的任何一个世纪比较而言的话，是比较和平的。实际上，我们在座的各位都是非常有这方面的思想，有这方面的这个研究，那么在这个过程当中呢，就很有必要，就我们这个宗教也好，或者说是学者也好，按照我们大乘佛教的这个思想的话呢，就是这个利他，今天有些教授也在讲这个将来这个大乘佛教跟其他佛教之间的有什么差别，就其实我们这个大乘佛教就是指无私的这个利他，是大乘佛教的这种究竟这个思想，所以按照大乘佛教的真正是利他思想的话呢，无论是你有没有信仰，就是自己是在善良的这个心态当中呢，就是你的思想、你的创作、你的所有的行为呢，就是帮助我们这个人类的这种和平。其实这样的这种行为呢，就我觉得是在我们人世间当中是最有价值的。还有一个想补充的呢，就是我们这个现在也好，过去也好，有时候是给大家做的这种宣传或者是广告呢，就是没有什么可信赖的。有时候我们可能政治家就是他依靠到达他的目的来，他可能会触化就是某个民族、某个这个团队。有时候是他那个就是经济就是为了达到他的这个目的的话呢，就是他可能会赞美，过于的赞美，或者是这样的。有时候是宗教徒呢，也是为了到达他的目的的话呢，他也可能有各种这个带有颜色的一些宣传。我觉得这些都是不是正向的，就是应该是所有的就是一切就是人们就是有一些到达自己目的的特意去宣传的这种行为的话呢，历史上也是这样的。我们这个人类做到今天是有经验的。